Ladies and gentlemen, this event is a lecture by Mark Blitz. Mark Blitz is the Fletcher Jones Political Philosophy Professor at Claremont McKenna College. He's one of ours, both as BA and at Harvard in the Government Department, and his PhD as well. He's written some books, and I wonder if you remember the titles of any of them.
I do.
There's one on Heidegger. Right. What's the title of it?
Heidegger's Being in Time and the Possibility of Political Philosophy.
All right. There's one called The Duty of Responsibility.
Right. Duty bound responsibility in American public life. It's good.
There's one on conservatism.
There is.
There's one on conservatism.
Conserving liberty.
There's one on Plato.
And there's one on Plato. Called here. That's the easiest title. Plato's Political Philosophy.
Yeah. All right. That's enough?
Yeah, that's enough. That's more than enough.
All right. Well, good. So Mark will talk for a due amount of time and entertain questions.
Yeah, thanks.
So please begin.
So thanks for that introduction, as they always say. Yeah, so thanks for that introduction. And you know, my talk is called Natural Limits and the Origin of Basic Political Concepts, probably different from many of the other talks. And, you know, if there's something I say which is really irritating or obscure or bizarre as I'm going along, please just interrupt. You don't have to store it all up in anger and annoyance till the time I'm finished. So my purpose today is to very briefly discuss how best to think about and understand basic political phenomena and concepts, and meaning by that apart from specific texts, but of course connected to specific texts. And let me begin just by claiming that the most sensible way to begin is to examine current usage and understanding thoughtfully. I'm here also this weekend for a small conference on Antonin Scalia. And if you consider what Scalia or other original meaning, not original intention, but other original meaning judges do, you also see, I think, why this is a sensible beginning, or even in a way a necessary one. So for example, liberty or freedom at first means being unhindered, being directed by yourself, not another, those two meanings. One reason to begin this way, current usage and understanding, is because there can't be any certain beginning from which one could deduce what's true in some absolute way. And that's really my first point. I think that limit is also true of any religious beginning. Perhaps more controversial point. Why can't there be any certain beginning? Because any so-called certain statements must be intelligible, and this means that its meaning, certain statement, and therefore its truth depends on phenomena that are uncertainly grasped. That's why there can't be a certain beginning. Stated positively, in understanding liberty or justice or the common good, we always begin from some context of intelligibility that we're immersed in. That's what leads people to discuss hermeneutical circles and to doubt that we can discover natural or permanent limits. And I think that that's a very powerful view. What needs challenging here, I think, is not the view that we're always immersed, but rather the view that hermeneutical circles must be understood as necessarily temporal and historical, or geographical, or derived from identity limits, or narratives, as they say now. The immersion from which we begin needn't be seen in this way. One can capture the merits or inevitability of contextual understanding without the usual relativism, something I want to indicate. And that's my second point. And I think that's a particular virtue of concentrating on Plato. So for instance, talking about Plato, the discussion of philosophy in the dialogue devoted to philosophy, The Lovers, begins from common views. It's perhaps noble and serious is one view. Perhaps it's merely babbling is another more reasonable view. A philosopher might be a polymath, and so on. Begins from those views, begins from one's those views. Now, all that said, although it's necessary, I think, to begin with current meaning, the difficulty with merely abstracting the current meaning that governs some specific examples is precisely that one forgets the context, so that one doesn't recognize that one is implicitly using a narrow experience, a narrow range of a particular kind of example in formulating one's view. So in being free, understood immediately as being unhindered, for example, the issue is unhindered for what? And one always implicitly has something in mind. And basically, first of all, it's unhindered for satisfying desires. So one forgets, or one doesn't see, that what one has just understood as freedom generally is really only liberal democratic. Three remedies, I think, for this problem of erroneous abstraction, you might say, that I'll discuss. One is to think a little bit more about the character of concepts and of contexts and of their interrelation. And let me develop this first remedy. First of all, when one thinks about concepts, one thinks first of all of mental constructs or compositions, artificial or created means of grasping, what the kind of thing we associate, let's say, with Descartes. But in fact, there's always a link between concepts and experiences, and a link between concepts and perception. Heidegger brings this, brings out one basis for this in a very elementary way. You see and hear things, motorcycles revving, say, and not bare sense data that you later somehow attach to motorcycle. And these things themselves belong to a context of use and a context of direction and a context of purpose. There are not some free-floating sense data or vague entities such as being vehicular, you know, which would be the abstract notion. If you're allergic to Heidegger, this link between concept and perception is also clear from, let's say, Plato's Theaetetus, though it's especially clear from Heidegger's interpretation of Plato's Theaetetus. The point is that there is always some understanding embedded in experience, and experience embedded in explicit understanding. And this precedes or runs ahead of any further understanding or experience. So when the phenomenologists say, and this again would be perhaps especially true of Heidegger, when the phenomenologists discuss intentionality and the link between phenomenon and intentionality, I think they have this. They have this in mind. So that when you then look at, let's say, Plato and Aristotle from this point of view, as let's say Strauss did to begin with, you have this in mind as well. So surfacing this narrowness is one remedy for thoughtless abstraction when you're trying to think about or understand things such as freedom and the common good and so on. Second remedy comes from seeing the connection between experience and understanding, or experience and intelligibility, and the contextual nature of concepts, The second remedy comes from seeing that this connection between experience and intelligibility and the contextual nature of concepts is not limited to particular disconnected phenomena, but involves others too. So, for example, in John Locke and Lockean liberalism, freedom, voluntariness, and liberty are about the choice of which means to satisfy which desires. Satisfaction is pleasure. Pleasure is relief from unease. Property or power is what can relieve unease. Value or good is what we can add to or unlock from nature to relieve unease. And institutions and traditions, including religion, are at root voluntary and consensual and private. So that these concepts and then the experiences connected to them interlock. And therefore, to understand any one of them properly, freedom, voluntariness, consent, and so on, to understand any one of them properly, one needs to keep in mind this interlocking richness. And then to develop this interdependence as far as one can in its unity. And ultimately, that's actually what it means to understand Locke, or anybody else for that matter. So this enriches, though not fully, but enriches the still narrow understanding of any concept, freedom, rights, whatever you're working with. Today's thinking about liberty and equality would benefit from considering them in terms of their overall connection to modern liberalism, would bring out their connection to rights, acquisitiveness, consent, tolerance, and speech and religion, as opposed to group identity. And as opposed, let's say, to favoring redistribution over acquisition. So those are the first two remedies. The third remedy for narrow abstraction involves considering other thinkers and regimes. Classic example is Plato, whose, what you might call, whose conceptual examinations have in mind, obviously, a wider context than our liberalism. So, for example, freedom concerns the self-mastery or self-direction involved in virtue and ultimately in liberal education, not only pleasure. Pleasure arrives together with seeing something beautiful, or arrives together with doing something noble. It's not only filling a lack, and certainly not only relieving unease. So then, when we abstract freedom, rights, whatever one is looking at, to look at it, and to try to understand it, we see more than when we merely implicitly are considering freedom, pleasure, desire in liberalism. And then these different contexts, or if you like, regimes, also affect how we experience and understand virtue and beauty and so on. Well, so in some sense, I think this, in some sense, this should be obvious, in some sense. But it's what's neglected, let's say, when philosophy professors talk about freedom or justice, or especially what's neglected when political scientists compare institutions, or when politicians defend something they call liberty or equality. It's even neglected, I'd say, when one studies only one or two thinkers, however carefully. And this also means that seeing each intellectual or political or historical context as hermetically sealed is another mistake. So that's the first part of my talk. Now, my talk was billed as, I billed it as, it's not that someone else is responsible for this, natural limits and the origin of basic concepts. So I'll now say something about that and try to connect it a bit to what I've been discussing. What is a natural limit? By natural, I mean, and it's not just that I mean it, this is the case, I'd say. By natural, I mean what we don't make or produce. That's one thing. The spontaneous, if you like, from the everyday, be natural, which means be spontaneous, don't be so artificial. Ultimately, maybe the central causes of things. And produce here, natural is what we don't make or produce. Produce here doesn't only mean to make or create. It also means to come forward or be brought forth in the way you might say produce the evidence, produce the prisoner, and so on. That is why, for instance, Heidegger, perhaps confusingly, as people see it, puts together nature and production, or why the understanding of nature somehow is in the ambit of this discussion of production. So you might say the natural, in this sense, is what brings itself forth by itself.
Brings itself to the eye?
Yeah, usually to the eye, certainly for the Greeks, but it wouldn't only be to the eye, right? Because ultimately what's brought forth to the eye is really brought forth to the ear in conversation, and then it's brought forth to no sense in particular, right? But to begin with, right, to the eye. Yeah, and then the third thing I think that natural means, well, the second thing, I don't want to pass over that, the second thing is the natural also means what is general or universal about something, as in someone's gentle nature or angry nature, what's general or universal about something. But this generality needn't be identical so that the reason of human beings is natural but hardly equal, unfortunately, one might say. And that's obviously one of the things that differentiates Plato's ideas, which are reflective and imitative, or which allow reflection and imitation, from universal laws. And then the third thing that the natural means is what is basic or essential, what shapes the rest. You know, our reason, for example, again, as opposed to our toenails or our earlobes and so on, which might fit these other criteria, right? But not this one. So one has to add that too. So that's what the natural means, roughly speaking. Limits, natural limits. A limit means what finishes or ends. One thing it means, or what surrounds or encloses, and therefore defines and separates, and therefore gives direction and meaning. So an end can be a stopping point, the limit of my endurance, let's say, or your endurance for me, or a limited supply, or it can be a more complete end, the furthest limit of someone's talent, let's say. Or, as I said, a limit can also be a defining shape or perimeter, the limit of one's property. And also, in this sense, a limit, in a way, just as an end is in many cases, is really the beginning point for what goes on within it. So, a limit as an end or a limit as a defining shape or perimeter. So natural limits would then be the defining enclosures and ends and their interconnections that give things their beginnings and that are unmade, essential, and somehow universal. Defining enclosures and ends, their interconnections that give things their beginnings that are unmade, essential, and universal. And basic concepts, or we can, I think, maybe call them, thinking phenomenologically, basic phenomena because of this link between concept and experience, where they're never simply separate, as you see it, let's say, in Plato. basic concepts or phenomena, basic political ones, are the divisions that orient us politically and that we use in political discussions. And then they would be the usual examples in some order and relation: freedom, the common good, virtue, happiness, trust, rule, tradition, power, rights, democracy, representation, the noble, the individual. So now, the points that connect studying basic concepts or phenomena and natural limits are these. First point, to fully understand a concept, say virtue, is to see it as a limit in the sense I discussed it, as an end or as a defining enclosure. So I'm claiming. You can certainly disagree. So that's the first point of the connection. To fully understand a concept such as virtue is to see it as a limit in the sense I discussed, as an end or as a defining enclosure. And for this, second point, one needs to see it in relation to other concepts and its practical or intellectual concepts. Context. For this, one needs to see it in relation to other concepts and its practical or intellectual context. The Locke example that I used would be the example of that. Because no one of these phenomena is the complete end. But then you also need to consider it in terms of its instances as one sees it elsewhere. So the Locke versus Plato example, as I used it. So in general, here's another big claim in understanding. There's a kind of dialectic between a phenomenon as we first abstract it from its context or appearance, and then enrich it, freedom, the example, and then enrich it by reconnecting it to this context, liberal freedom and the other things connected to it, and then see its relation to other contexts of thought and action, the Platonic understanding or Hegelian understanding, and then try to enrich and better understand these contexts, and so on, and so on. This kind of, maybe another way to say this dialectical understanding is even more complicated and difficult than it simply seems, you know, when you're looking at separate contexts or, in a sense, separate ideas. And this kind of dialectic lets us, I think, again, this claim, come closest to grasping the natural context and its natural elements, which is ultimately the goal, right? Working this through enables one to see what's richest and most comprehensive and leaves out the least, but also enables one to, I think, take into account and deal with what is always this powerful claim that all understanding is somehow located within an interpretive context, the so-called hermeneutical circle. Now, of course, as I said, and I'll end with this thought, this dialectic leads to great complexity in trying to understand anything, goes without saying. But these complexities and difficulties are also announced in these certain kind of human phenomena which announce to us our discursive limit and pretentiousness. laughter, perplexity, wonder, political choice. There are certain series of phenomena which as such announce to us the limits of kind of discursive understanding, which forces on one a certain modesty. And I'll end on that note of false modesty, if you like, as well. So I'm happy to talk about any of the things I discussed or other things that you think might be relevant.
I enjoyed that. So there were two parts to your talk. And the first part, you mostly talked about the concepts, but especially political concepts, and you emphasized, on the one hand, that the political concepts are disputable, and on the other hand, you did not close the door to coming to some certain understanding eventually. Now, when you t- talked about in the second part of your talk, where you talked about nature, you did not so much emphasize that nature is something disputable. So I could give some simple examples, right? That Plato and Aristotle in the classical tradition seem to think that there is something like nature and natural limits. But outside of the classical tradition, you have, you know, the biblical tradition, according to which you would, could say there are natural limits, or in the case of Heidegger, who would say things like, he would at least verbally deny the principle of sufficient reason, and he'll say things like, the beings as beings come out of the nothing. And I don't think Plato or Aristotle would, they didn't say that. So if you want to argue that they believed it, you take some work. In any case, so I wondered why you didn't do that, because it seems to me important that nature is something disputable. And this comes up, I would say, even in political experience. So if you think of something like human freedom and moral experience, some interpretations of our experience would hold that there isn't something like nature. That is, that there aren't natural limits, everything isn't determined, and we're free to do what we wish apart from nature. And then there are other experiences and other interpretations of experience according to which it seems that everything is determined. So it seemed to me you came to your happy ending with the political, the, you know, disputable nature of political things to the possibility of some certain ending in their interpretation, perhaps because you treated nature as something that is known and not disputable.
Yeah, sure. Well, thanks for that. All good points, and let me talk a little bit about them. Yeah, I don't think one could have a certain understanding, that's for sure. If certainty means from an absolute beginning and reaching absolute ends, so I wouldn't say it or wouldn't put it in that in those terms.
Well,
exactly.
I would love to rephrase it a more modest version. Just, you could make a rational judgment about which interpretation is superior to another.
That's right. And I think the way you have to do that is in this dialectical way that I discussed. So that you have to begin from where you begin, because you know, and to me that basically, first of all, means from where one is and one's current understanding. Try to see what one is taking for granted in that, because there are always these other interconnections, free to what, always, that you implicitly have in mind. Think that through in terms of all of the concepts or phenomena that are correlated with it, you might say, the example liberalism, and then go on in the way in which I said, without saying that you would arrive at a complete endpoint, but with nonetheless claiming, yes indeed, that one understands more and more and more of these things which in a certain way are necessarily disputable. So that's one thing I'll say. I'll come back to that in a minute. You know, nature itself, as I discussed it, I did discuss in more general terms, right? Because, you know, one only has X amount of time. But it would also be the case, this would be the claim, which could be wrong, that the understanding of what nature itself means is correlated in just these ways. So that nature understands, so it is as a kind of efficient causality, or in a mathematical physical way, or as meaning universality in the sense of identity, some of the things that I pointed out, I would say they're connected to that as well, so that one would need to go through something like the same process to uncover what is natural more fully, which would be somehow the fullest context which brought you the richest and most complete, but always, of course, indeed, necessarily incomplete kind of understanding. A third point maybe to make is that in practical affairs, but not of course so much in theoretical affairs, in practical affairs you draw a circle around this kind of endlessness, because the question is, why am I asking, or what do I need to know for? Maybe a good example would be voluntary action. You know, you shouldn't punish would-be criminals if their actions are not voluntary. And it doesn't take all that long to work your way all the way up there to the mystery of freedom of will, say there is no such thing as freedom of will, and therefore say, well, why are we punishing any of these people? Right? Though it's not exactly clear to whom you're saying it, because the person to whom you're saying it is supposed to then act on this statement freely. So, you know, these great difficulties. But you draw the circle around that practically, of course, by asking, why is it that I want to know whether or not there's voluntary action here? It's for the purpose of guilt or punishment within the context of a certain set of practical affairs. So that's I think, why in practice these questions are not simply endless, but can be look more that way theoretically, but they're not simply endless and altogether endless. Heidegger. You know, the point always is that the human characteristics are the characteristics that we have as we're open to being, that nature, especially as the pre-Socratics first understood it, came almost close to seeing being and our openness to being, but almost immediately, and then certainly with Plato, became simply a general way to talk about entities. But I don't think that means in Heidegger's case that either the discussion of nature is meaningless or that being arises from nothing, if by that one means comes into being because of. Rather, it means something more like to understand anything as it is also to understand the things with that meaning that are not.
So to repeat
that. Yeah, but I'll give an example which will make it less. So to understand anything as it is to understand the things of that meaning which are not. So that, for example, you understand the presence of these reading glasses in a powerful way when they're missing and lost. And knowing what you're looking for and knowing the context of meaning in terms of which you would find them is every bit as powerful. Mm-hmm. So that there's an absence or a lack which is co-determinative with the presence of anything. And that gets located back down into a certain understanding of meaning. To use, you know, maybe his most well-known example from being in time, one of the ways in which you most understand a work world, let's say you're building something in your garage, a treehouse for your child. No one does this anymore, but in circles such as this, but they still do it out in the real world, I think. It's when the tool is missing. It's when something is broken. Absent, broken, missing, all of which is connected to the nothing and negation, that in a certain powerful sense, you see the meaning and presence of the rest of it. I think he means something more like that than things which would smack of bringing into being out of nothing.
Can I just, on this understanding, I think you're saying that Plato and Heidegger are not necessarily so far apart when it comes to their understanding of nature. Is that correct?
Yeah, I'm saying,
at least on this point.
Yeah, well, I'm saying two things. I'm saying in one sense that Plato and, let's say, the phenomenologists, which would mean Heidegger, are not so far apart. I'm certainly saying. In terms of whether or not their human characteristics have to be understood in terms of an openness to being such as what Heidegger has in mind, or whether what he has in mind can be sufficiently understood in Platonic terms, that's, of course, a deep question.
Yeah, I guess the reason I wanted to ask that is that you spoke of nature in such a way that it was broad enough that it could possibly describe Plato and someone like Heidegger, but then I think you would have the question, why doesn't Heidegger have this dialectical investigation of virtue and of politics that you describe as sort of naturally following from this understanding of nature? And I would just posit he doesn't have such a thing, and then you would wonder why.
Yeah, why do his students sort of begin it? And And he doesn't.
Okay.
If they do it, you, is one thing you could say.
Okay.
Yeah, I think, you know, the broad answer is that he believes he can explain and understand human characteristics to begin with in terms of openness to being more broadly. That's the first thing I'd say. The second thing I'd say is Heidegger, after all, has to find a ground to explain the meaning of all of these philosophers who came after Plato and Aristotle as not merely mistakes, right, but as something. And therefore, it has to locate it back down into something else, which is one thing he does. And a third thing, you mentioned faith or religion. When you look at Heidegger's, again, being in time mostly now, mode of proceeding, a lot of it is about a path of movement or a path of activity, similar in certain ways to religious faith having to do with acting in a certain way, even if the results seem ridiculous, right? Acting in the righteous way, walking in the proper path. And Heidegger will often describe, and people will also describe for him, his activity in this way, not in the sense of faith, because Heidegger strictly distinguishes theology and philosophy, but in the sense of the way in which you understand how the human characteristics are what they are. So all of those things, maybe you could say. And then if, and then a fourth thing, if one wanted to be more dismissive and less, mm-hmm. and less friendly to Heidegger, is saying that deep as his understanding is of Plato and Aristotle, and surely deeper than anybody else's up to his time, he would say, mm-hmm. it's insufficient. Mm-hmm. At least Plato. Plato more visibly than Aristotle, I'd say. Yeah.
In your previous mention of the Heidegger's idea that it's only when something, a tool, breaks down or starts to function improperly that when people start to think about its deeper purpose or deeper meaning. But transferring this to political problem, can we say that it's when the political order begins to have problems or have fallen to a certain state of incapacity that the deeper questions now have come to surface? It's
in, you could say something like that in the following way. Heidegger, it's not so much that you think of the purpose, it's that you see the whole context in a certain way which you merely took for granted, right? You're just going about your business of building this thing. And the whole context comes to light for you when something that's essential isn't there anymore. And it would be something like that if you transferred it politically. But the other time in which this happens is in founding, right? When you found or begin is where the interconnection of all of it somehow is present. It certainly is if there is an intentional founder. When there's not an intentional founder, and this is why I began by talking about so-called original meaning rather than original intention, then it's more likely that that one of the times you might see this would be with this breakdown. But it should also be the case that any time you have to make any political choice, if you played it out enough, but normally in practice you wouldn't have this distance, if you played it out enough, you could see. What's happening. Yeah, Susan and Bob.
So thank you. I mean, very rich and much to think about. So two things. Firstly, I'm a small thing. I'm just struck that when in your definition of nature, the word necessity didn't come up. And I wondered, you know, you might want to comment on that because that's one of the attributes of nature, at least that one might think of. Secondly, your account is curiously Hegelian.
Is that good or bad?
The
Hegelian part is good, but curiously is bad.
The more comprehensive, the better. That instead of true and false, we have more and less comprehensive. And as things become, and so that's a sort of replacement for, in a certain sense, for. So I guess I'm wondering when. So I'm assuming that you think Plato is more comprehensive than Locke. That the Plato regime, as you put it, is more comprehensive than the Locke regime because Plato can give an account of Locke, can make Locke's regime intelligible, but that Locke can't make Plato's regime intelligible. That somehow Locke's vision is narrower, contains less, can make less intelligible to us than Plato's, who can make locked in time.
Or the object of his thought. The object of his thought, yeah.
But so presumably there could be something later that, or one might find something more comprehensive later. Right, right. So I'm wondering if you could, again, there's a certain formality to that.
I try to make it informal to the degree I could in this small time by starting with something like freedom, where you start with, let's say you start with now, you show the interconnections, which is one way of making even that narrow understanding that we have of freedom somewhat broader. But then you also try to work through what's missing and what it's connected to, and so on. So the idea is, you could say comprehensive, but that still gives it a certain vagueness. It's, you know, the mode of thinking, this is maybe the Platonic mode of thinking, right? Not just the Hegelian mode, is to be very concrete together with your generality. That's what it would mean, not just theoretically, but practically, if you think of a regime, to the degree to which a political regime now is closed. They're not simply closed, they can't be. That's what happens. All of these institutions somehow fit. And if you're showing they're incomplete, it's not merely that you sort of float them to another level of abstraction, but that you try to do that concretely with each of the measures in each of the institutions. So I don't know that I disagree exactly with what you said, but it makes it more vague and abstract than my intention was. Or if you think even now, separate from that, of the way in which in any of the dialogues you try to think through what an idea means, right? It's not that you simply lay on it some greater word or set of words or broader circle, but that you pick up again and take up again each time, right? All of the substance in the somewhat mislaid and put to the side understanding. I have something somewhat more like that in mind. But we'll talk on the second point of necessity, or the first point of necessity and nature. The first meaning of the natural is the spontaneous, and that ultimately means the causal. So that's how I would think of, you know, and that precisely means what you can't get out of. So that's how I would mean it. If by necessity one means something other than that, you know, one sometimes has in mind the lower or more ordinary necessities, the ordinary as opposed to the excellent, the fact that you eat, as opposed to the set of manners that you bring to the table, you might say. And I'm not sure that you can ever 100% separate out necessity in that sense. That would be an interesting question, from some manner that of human shaping, you know, which brings it beyond simply the animal necessity. So that's what I would say about necessity in that sense. But in the first sense, if one is talking about a meaning of nature being the spontaneous, ultimately that means the things which cause but are not themselves cause, and that be one of the things one might mean by necessity or necessary. So I think I include it without using the word, which you're right, I didn't.
Yeah. What's an absolute beginning? Is that something like the state of nature?
I think it's the Cartesian beginning. It's what Descartes is interested in, right? An absolute beginning, a standpoint which is absolutely certain, from which you can work out everything else, right? I mean, that's the classic example of what would appear to be an absolute beginning that doesn't get reached by, you know, some other circular basis, but which can be stated clearly and distinctly, and again, from which you can deduce everything else, something a little bit more axiomatic. So the state of nature, I think, is already too complex for that. It would be more, I mean, if one's looking at Locke, though Locke doesn't quite proceed this way, it'd be more some of the things you'd see in the essay, you know, right, which is, you know, more Cartesian in that way.
So do you think?
No, go ahead.
So you said this metaphorically, but I just want to know how metaphorically or literally you treat a kind of set of concepts that interlock because of Locke, according to the workings out of a thinker like Locke. You called it a regime. Is that Did you mean that in a very metaphorical sense, or do you mean it rather more literally?
I mean both things.
And Plato too was a regime?
No, I meant yeah. two things, and I meant to be to leave them in that way. It's easiest to see. I meant both the actual political regimes. So in the Platonic Aristotelian sense, the democracies, the oligarchies, the aristocracies, and so on, which have a certain kind of unity. Let's say Book 8 of Plato's Republic, where you can see this maybe most clearly. They have that certain kind of unity in all sorts of things, and you could press that, I think, very far. But then the second place you would see it clearly is in the kind of regimes, ours, which actually have something close to an intended founder. For this purpose, I used Locke. I ultimately mean not the political regime literally or the thinker literally, but what they are about and what they reflect. Right. So you could call that a third thing if you want. But I did also have in mind the actuality of thought within or action within. A particular political regime. If you want to use the word horizon, but the horizon would be part of it. But it's the way the limit, the horizon. That's you could use that term for limit, right? Structures everything else within it. But the horizon is not just intellectual. I mean, I take this to be one of the great discoveries in looking back at Plato and Aristotle, no longer from a kind of Christian point of view. Or British public school point of view, or however one wants to think of that, but to see that that's what the political community is. That's what it means to call a regime a form. It forms. Maybe another way to say that is that horizon is okay, but form is good because forms form. You know, they organize. They don't merely enclose.
But they obfuscate. They're caves.
Yes, but everything obfuscates in just the way I suggested. Yeah. Everything obfuscates in just the way I suggested, because you're always taking for granted in talking about anything, all sorts of things which you don't know or don't think
so
that you're taking for granted.
So Plato defined his own cave?
No.
Like which other caves?
No, Plato is working towards the non-cave cave. It's Hegel who defines his own cage, you could say, you know, if one talks out. Bob?
First of all, I admire the ambition of your paper, trying to think this out, so to speak, afresh, and think a very large problem out. I had difficulty with your emphasis upon context. Which leads to the emphasis upon the whole and a comprehensive comparison of wholes. Because it wasn't clear to me how one gets, what is it that is natural that enables one to measure contexts and compare them? I have that difficulty. But a second problem seems to me that you overlook the contradictions within a country, and within not just the country, but within our situations. So it seems to me that thoughtfulness, and for that matter, philosophy, can arrive because of that, not because one is comparing whole, I'm not sure the right word, cultures, whole civilizations.
Regimes is a good word.
That's your word. But,
right.
But it's in a way a certain political presumption that leads you to call that a regime, as opposed to the rather separable set of opinions. There might be a variety of countries, regimes, which nevertheless are influenced by Christianity, for example, but nevertheless they can be very different. There's sort of a difference between this broad set of ideas and particular questions of who rules with what limited attitudes. But I'm more interested in just what seems to be your abstraction from the obvious Platonic process, which is raising questions within the context of a certain country, and one gets beyond that country by raising difficulties about this opinion as to beauty, or that opinion as to courage or whatever, that there's a clarification that takes place without the kind of comprehensive comparison you mentioned.
Yeah, I meant to do both. Ultimately, you need something like the comprehensive comparisons, but not only the comprehensive comparisons. The whole point, in a way, of my beginning the way I began is to suggest that if you simply look at something like freedom or liberty and have this general understanding of what it is, simply within it itself, you can go far in two directions. One is the first one I discussed, where you actually see that when you're talking about liberty, ultimately you have in mind, without knowing it, the range of other institutions and activities in something like liberal democracy. But that the other thing is to precisely, in a certain sense, bring in the possibilities of other opinions. I mean, if you want to say that those are somehow there in most cases, also in practice to be found one way or another, I don't disagree with that. That's why I ended by trying to point to the phenomena of perplexity, wonder, ridicule or laughter, or choice and political choice. Those are the four I mentioned, just for that reason. Just for that reason. But that doesn't do away with the fact that, and the reason for that is because all of these modes of thought, political regimes, would-be wholes, even more so with culture and civilization, which are so historical, are imperfect. Precisely because they're imperfect, you will find their imperfections. But what do you do with that imperfection? Seems to me it's not simply enough to jump from this narrow view of liberty or beauty to a slightly broader one, but to also see how any of those phenomena is connected to all the others in what you're first thinking about. And that'll give you a much deeper understanding of the phenomenon than simply to point out the limits of that phenomenon itself. But I certainly didn't mean to suggest, so thanks for pointing out if I did, that these limits can't be seen to announce themselves within any regime or context. They must, because of, and we have, not just as a general statement, but they're concrete phenomena that we have of perplexity and wonder and political choice, ridicule and so on, which are hard to explain except because they do that. They show these kinds of limits. I think I would dispute, however, the real importance of what one is loosely calling culture or civilization or all Christianity has A, B, and C. I don't think that that's not in some way there, but I don't think at the end that it can't be, that all of that can't be broken back to a natural or rational, not historical or religious context. That would be the question there, right?
Can I raise a question that I meant to add? Do you acknowledge that to some extent in our initial opinions there is a kind of perception or truth to some extent, for example, when we talk of a tree, or when we talk of freedom, that there's something there, or that when the Frenchman, the tribal man, the American and such, they all in a way take for granted that they're talking about men.
Yeah, the point.
But do you grant that?
I mean, initial
perception that at least of, to use the Platonic phrase, some of kinds of things.
Yeah, I guess what I'm saying is that is two things really. There's no question, but the point is, in a way, that the initial perception has to contain within it and have surrounded by it more than it says. I'm precisely trying to show that, or indicate, or argue, or claim, whatever, that all of the virtues that come from this historicist way of thinking are actually things that you can salvage, because I think there's a lot of power in them, in a deeper or more rational way of thinking. So that's the argument. That's the argument that I'm making. Do you first simply see some differences among beings? Sure you do, but it's very difficult to divide those properly by species very difficult once you start talking about them. And you know, it may be that there's some simple levels at which everyone everywhere is saying exactly the same thing. I doubt it, though, in very much. Where they're ultimately saying the same thing is as an imperfect version of the true thing. That's what I would come closer, much closer to saying something like that, in fact. Right? It's hard to discuss man very long without discussing good man, proper choice. Well, so as soon as you do that, you take along with it the original notion of what man might have been. It's hard even to, when you really think about it, say what a chair is without almost immediately beginning to talk about the use of the chair or what it's used for or good use. It's extremely difficult to do that. Even the mere material or the mere shape is taken up into the use or the purpose in a funny way. So it's an exercise. It's not to be taken for granted. It's an exercise to see whether or not there's some root level that's, in a certain sense, not intellectually the most in question that one can even get to, or whether that root level always is some deflection from a much fuller understanding. That would be, you know, I'm not so sure that it's not like that for almost everything that matters. I leave that open.
I have to ask and run. Sorry about the running.
It's better than running than asking.
You didn't stay for an answer.
Assume that the answer is adequate, and then run.
Okay, well, isn't the most obvious challenge when you're discussing political concepts that they are so dependent on cultural context, or if you will, opinion? So, a word that we often like, conservative. The same word in French, it means something totally different. It doesn't exist in Hebrew or in Arabic, as far as I know. You might then try to find other concepts that are common. I don't know, government, war, you can try. But I think just in general, the overwhelming sway of opinion and its influence on everything that is discussed in politics, it means that you're always appealing to a specific context. And you know, when you're discussing nature, well, let's assume that we don't think that cows are holy, and you could at least find some common ground amongst, you could say, you know, educated or philosophic members of different cultures.
So that's an extreme cultural relativism, and that's
when discussing politics, you have to appeal to opinion.
Yeah, but that's different. That's an extreme kind of cultural relativism, which I don't think would be correct. It's certainly not the case, I don't think, that in discussing French politics with someone French, there wouldn't be lots of levels of mutual intelligibility up to a certain point, and certainly much more of that in, let's say, two members of a liberal democracy, yeah, when they're talking about how they use cows, and when you're talking with your French friend about how he's using his cow in his restaurant, or and so on, than, let's say, in the example that you had in mind. So I don't think that extreme relativism is accurate. It strikes me as not accurate. Though I don't think that the absolute complete universality really quite exists in that root or base level either. No? Right?
Well, it would seem to me that if you might have a fixed end in mind, but you couldn't get there unless you appeal to the opinion.
Yeah, that's the rhetoric. That's the rhetoric of politics. And you know, a good politician is better at that, I would say, than we are. And it's always unclear how much the more they know ruins their ability. Or diminishes their ability to talk persuasively and intelligently. Lincoln is our great example of having it both ways.
Yeah.
Right, but though maybe we make of Lincoln a little bit more philosophically we just attribute things, which may be so, may not so. I mean, there's nothing, you know, there's not much on the record which would enable you to see that. But you can be awfully successful politically without being Lincoln, but you can also be awfully successful politically talking good sense, but in terms that can be understood. I don't quite see why that's not possible. It has its limits at some point. That's current opinion, though. That's more current than anything I have in mind. So we'll go here. Students first.
Okay. Thank you for the presentation. My question is about, within a given horizon, the openness of possibility, rather than, say, one horizon, kind of one context compared to another context. So I'm thinking, you know, book three of the politics, party of like as like, party of unlike as unlike, but they each have a partial view, and they sort of, you can, at least in theory, reach a whole, a view of the whole, and you want to see further than the parties. My question would be that. Each has, they both are within the same regime, they're both in the same form, but within that they still have the partial experiences. How do you see, just within one horizon, what is the possibility of breaching what seems to be a mutable horizon between the two?
I don't know that the horizon would have to be mutable, but it would be a somewhat richer or fuller. My picture of this is a little bit more a spiral, where you have the separate concept, let's say justice, and its substance, and the substance of that is it actually comes to life in a fuller way in either of those two regimes, and then the concept again more fully and richly understood. So as we're now moving our way to this mythical aristocracy, that would be the example there. They both come together in a certain kind of aristocracy as the regime which properly encompasses equal equals, unequal unequals. That's what I would understand it as. And I'd understand it that way, not just practically, but even in intellectually trying to think through what those things mean.
So each goes by kind of its own spiral, and they start spiraling together?
Each is this when you're thinking about it, not as they are, because thinking about it is not the same as they are. Yes, in a certain sense that's right, but it's mostly that any political community or intellectual way of thinking is about a bunch of things. It's never about just one thing. You're not simply thinking about like to like, unlike to unlike. You're also thinking about the related experience of virtue, the related experience of freedom, the related experience of legislation, the related experience of dividing up the political offices, all of these Aristotelian things. So the question is, if you're then isolating one for judgment, let's say an important one such as justice, you've got to see what the context is from which you've isolated it, and then think about it more fully in terms of, in this case, the other piece of justice, right? But then think of that also in terms of the full context within which it exists, in order then to reach a fuller understanding of how these political institutions work together, or even what a better political regime would be.
So this would be the dialectical understanding you were saying, which is the sort of discursive reasoning. We have this one part, and then we kind of compare it then with this other part, and we have an understanding of how far that goes, and then the two together, and then...
That's right. It's that kind of understanding of what a kind of dialectical understanding would be. That's right. It's what I'm claiming.
I have a bit of a follow-up question to Susan, because I'm not sure I followed your answer there, and it is related to, Susan said you didn't speak so much about what's true versus what's false, or even what's necessary versus something else, and you mentioned a richer understanding or fuller understanding of a concept. But in my somewhat cruder understanding of even what somebody like Plato is doing, it seems more that the what is questions and a dialectical investigation is less a richer understanding in a way of a phenomenon, but it's a weird shrinking down to, like, it's a reduction to something. So of course, if you have Book One of the Republic, you learn about all the things that people say are justice. So you do get a fuller understanding of all the opinions that you know, that are associated with this term, that it seems not that they're being, you know, stuffed in a bag and contextualized and shown where in the regime are these understandings necessary and so on. It seems more that Socrates is saying, well, but showing the defect with everything and kind of dissing it. And so it's not that, you know, at the end of book one, you have a full understanding of justice, but you're wondering, it's none of these things, so I'm left in a sense with nothing, or I have no idea what it is. And so this richness or fullness, it doesn't jive with my even experience of reading Aristotle or Plato. Also, when you read Aristotle at first, yes, you get a fuller picture of all your opinions, always. But then there's this sense of, but none of this is true, and they don't add up. And so there's...
So what I'd say, using the example of Plato, what you get after book one are those other nine books. So, and that's the nice thing about the Republic. It shows you what the other nine books would have been after you're left not knowing what courage is or moderation is or all the other things you're left not knowing.
And when you
work that through, it's fuller and more complex, because you see justice as it is at work in the soul, not merely as it is in the city. You see justice as it is at work in a variety of cities, not just in a particular city. And presumably you then see justice as it is the object of all of this kind of understanding. The Republic's maybe a good example for not that we get something narrower and narrower and simply abstract and formulaic, but something which is demonstrated in a greater complexity in, you know, along some of the lines that I'm arguing for. So that would be my case study.
But you would have to say all the false opinions that Socrates dismisses in book one, somehow they have to come back, or because this is how they are at work in real cities and so on.
But then
still we have this fact that they proved untrue in book one. And of course we have to live. We have to live together. We have to make things work. So sure, you have a practical necessity that you spoke about in your talk too. But that is different from, you know, what you said too, the theoretical understanding of what Bob said, the inherent contradictions of it.
Yeah, no, I don't see that exactly. The opinions in book one are all fall short, that's for sure. But then, as I say, you have the other nine books, or if you don't like, you know, the last two books, give me up through book eight, where you again show what justice is, and therefore make more sense both of those opinions and of the formal statement about what justice is, by showing it at play in this human soul, not just the political regime, and ultimately in the whole of things, as you study it and as you look at it. And then you even see it, if you're looking at book eight and you think about it in this way, you see the inferior opinions, or the partial opinions, if you like, from book one, as they would be if they had greater sway than they often have. So I think I'll cling to the view that the Republic is good evidence for me, not evidence against me. So.
If you say the whole book is dialectical, but I would not say that. You said specifically there's a dialectical method, but I'm not sure what you mean by that, unless you say, you know, there's this distinctive method of thinking that you find only in parts of the Republic, but not everywhere.
Yeah. So, but I wasn't, I, when I talked about this dialectical understanding, I didn't have in mind only and literally the dialectic by which you show any particular opinion to be partial. That's connected to that, but I had in mind what I said, which in a certain sense is illustrated by the entirety of something like the Republic, not simply book one and where it ends. One, two.
Okay. I guess somewhat along those lines, but you mentioned in a previous answer the spiral, thinking about it as a spiral. But when I was hearing your talk, I th- I maybe incorrectly pictured it more as a kind of tree with all these branches that you follow. And by looking at the different contexts and thinking through the different possibilities of a given context, you kind of enhance your own knowledge by creating this very complex structure. I guess then, is that wrong, and why it's wrong? Why is it wrong, and how does it fit in with some of the previous questions, like Anna's last question, in which she forced you to finally say soul, which didn't seem to be part of, or at least I missed.
It was there in my talk.
Well, but it doesn't. But that's my question. Where is it exactly? Because it doesn't seem to be part of this branched structure, and it doesn't. There doesn't seem to be a psychology, like the psychology in Plato and the Republic, where this the deep psychology comes out, the X-ray of each of these.
So I'd say, I mean, you know, these images are images, and with your background, you can probably think of a bunch of different possible shapes, which would be even better than spiraling. But the tree and the branches is a, you know, it's something kind of Cartesian. Heidegger talks sometimes about trees and branches. I don't see it as quite so unidirectional as the tree with branches would be, depending on what kind of branches you branches you have in mind. Because again, when you're thinking, you're coming back to what you let go and putting it in a deeper context and coming back again and putting it in a deeper context. It's not merely that the branches sort of shoot off from one place and remain in that place. So that's why that particular understanding. I mean, the soul, as we talk about it, is one place where forms and ends have their presence. That's so. So that's what I would say.
But how do you get...
And a certain notion or understanding of the soul is usually connected to, and especially the happiness or excellence of the soul, is usually connected to a certain political understanding.
Okay. But then how do you get to...
Or religious understanding?
Yeah, maybe religious understanding.
In the gods, if you have...
Maybe religious understanding, but we can come back to that,
But just to finish, in that... Okay, so they wrap around... And so that's where you make progress in thinking by kind of wrapping around. So it's an upward spiral.
Upward. Or it could be downward, depending on how lucky you are that day.
So thinking is not just abstracting.
No, it's certainly not.
It's just abstracting and then leading to rejecting.
That's right.
But it's
returning.
It's returning.
It's abstracting and returning and abstracting and returning and connecting. So, dividing and combining.
So clarity can never be reached, but only clarification.
Well, I think sufficient clarity can be reached depending on purpose. That's why I brought up this practical purpose, right? Uh-huh. Sufficient clarification depending on why it is you want to be clear. So for all sorts of practical purposes, including in a certain sense even practical academic or intellectual purposes, uh-huh. it might be sufficient.
And that would characterize modern philosophy.
The abstracting.
With its abstracting with an agenda.
Abstracting with an agenda and forgetting the interconnections, let alone everything else that it forgets. So that when modern philosophy, and especially modern contemporary version of modern philosophy, thinks about liberty and equality and justice, it's in a very thin way. Otherwise, they would think the way we think, or they would think more broadly in terms of the full range of what a liberal democracy requires. I would say
more than unease.
More than happiness is the relief of unease. Yeah. More than happiness is the relief from unease. Now maybe you don't believe that, but yes, more than that, which is what it is. Yeah.
I had a question on the relationship between the natural and the conceptual. You talk about natural limits. That's somehow the mark of what it is to give conceptual clarity, and some of these biblical concepts. And I guess I was wondering if you think natural limits are the same as, say, conceptual limits, or are they different, or how are they related? And it goes somewhat to Susan's point about necessity, that the the kind of necessity of the laws of thought, say, being subject to the principle of non-contradiction or the law of exclusion or some kind of necessity of thought. But they don't seem to be the same kind of necessity that characterizes nature or the limits or ends in your description of nature. And then you could also, it seems to me, ask the same thing about the psychological dimension.
So let me take two things about that. I use the word concept, but then I would, the point was to connect always the understanding and experience, and therefore would sometimes use it together with the word phenomenon, and that's what I mean, concept in that sense, so not simply abstracted from the experience. And I think that's true even of the laws of thought, as you're saying. And maybe the most interesting thing to look at here is as is often the case, Heidegger. Where do these laws of thought come from? They themselves take something for granted. And it's certainly true, and you don't need to look at Heidegger to say this, that even something about the statement of the principle of non-contradiction seems dependent on a particular notion of what it is that's not contradicting itself, of spatial dimension, of time, of the existence of the qualities or predicates that you're attributing as contradictory or not. So I don't think whatever you might be able then to find as an absolutely impossible to avoid way of thinking would go very far in telling you hardly anything. That's what I would say. Now that's, I'm asserting this, so you know.
You had a lot of interesting formulations. I wasn't able to hold on to all of them in my mind, but one I, and tell me if I'm misquoting, but you said in order to understand virtue, you have to see virtue as a limit. So I tried that out, you know. Maybe it's because at Harvard we see our virtue as boundless, but I guess it's easier for me to think of like the limits of justice, like, you know, can only slice the cake so evenly. Yeah. But the limits of seeing virtue as a limit, I'll give you an opportunity maybe to expand on that a bit. I didn't understand what that meant. I mean, one way you can think of a concept like virtue as a limit is by thinking of it as a concept, namely like a humanly constructed concept or a term which we've defined. And since we've defined it, we've limited it. We've given it a genus, a species, assignment, etc. So then it would be limited, but by us. We wouldn't be recognizing a limit nature per se. Another way would just be to say many beings are incapable of perfection, or human beings are not perfect beings, or whatever. But again, with virtue, if you just want to call it excellence, I don't see why you have to think of excellence as a limit, unless you think that's human excellence, but that would just be the limit of humanity, not of excellence. To give a very obvious example, this is actually one I even encounter people today say, still, political theorists don't usually use the word virtue, but the one virtue, say, love. They would speak about universal love or infinite love. Christians would speak of God's love. And again, it's the nature of the virtue of love or of compassion or is somehow tied up with it not being limited, with it being related to the universal or the infinite or God. So, but nevertheless, I'm sure you had something in mind with the limit. But how do you see an abstract theory of excellence and then the limit? I'm already...
That's good. So when I was at Harvard, we didn't think about virtue as unlimited. We thought that we could all become John F. Kennedy, and that's a kind of limited... That's a limited goal. We were more modest. We were more modest.
Your humility was limitless.
Yeah, that's right. Our humility was limitless. That's right. That's fair to say. Yeah, I would say this. No, by limit I meant, as I said, two things: a kind of an end, a kind of stopping point, and a kind of perimeter of fence around something from which it then has some meaning. If you think of love as a virtue, friendship, let's say, let's call it friendship so we can connect it to Aristotle, right? Is it or isn't it true that that to truly enjoy the good that virtue deals with properly, friends and lovers, in his view, that true enjoyment precisely is connected to an end or a limit where not every, not where universal love wouldn't be sufficient, where love couldn't be simply boundless, because you need to make choices about better and worse, because you can only be truly a friend of a limited number of people, a very limited number of people, at a very limited time, and so on. So the experience of virtue in this example, where it's connected to a measured enjoyment is a way of talking about, now, the limit or end in terms of which you understand, and not just understand, but even experience the thing. Love would be a very good example of that, forgetting for a minute the universality of love of modern philosophy, or even in a sense Christianity, but thinking of it more classically in the various gradations and types of friendship. So that's what I would say about that.
I just wonder if the theory of friendship in Aristotle, the divisions, if there isn't a kind of that the biblical gods in the Bible really provides the standard for all of these different types of love and compassion, and that you'd see the characters in the Bible display. And so Aristotle's division of friendship already, in a way, is getting rid of this idea of a being with who has infinite love or infinite virtue.
So that could be a
claim. I don't know.
Yeah, no, I certainly don't. That could be a claim that one would make. But one interesting way to deal with that, I began at the beginning by saying, you know, one obvious reason there can't be a certainty or an absolute beginning, it's because of the kind of immersion always in some context of meaning or intelligibility. I think that would be true for religion as well, for faith as well. So then the question would be whether it's not the reverse, the kind of phenomena you're talking about in relation to biblical love are understandable from the natural standpoint rather than vice versa. That would be the question in terms of, you know, the original intelligibility with which you experience and talk about and discuss love or the other phenomena.
Would you say here, from the natural standpoint, can be causal called from the human point of view? Would you?
I don't think I'd call it a human point of view, because you're trying to understand things which are not simply human, right? So, yeah. But it is those things as we understand them.
I mean, instead of Socrates, he only knows human things and not things above.
Yeah, but then the question is whether the human things point to the full whole or structure of things more than the literal things above, you know, like the stars and so on, right? So that if you look, let's say, I mentioned the lovers. Well, the lovers' dialogue begins with two boys in Dionysus's school imitating and trying to properly grasp mathematically the heavens. So that would be an example of the attempt to naturally understand something which is not simply human or reducible to the human, but which is also, and that's the implicit beginning of that dialogue, not the gods. It brackets the gods, right? Or the heavens as gods in that case.
Is every human being every human beginning moral? Your definition of context seems to be regime. A regime is based on fundamental moral experiences, or
dependent. Could I say dependent? Is that
dependent?
Is that fair?
Dependent.
Yeah, that I would certainly say. You know, man is by nature political. I read somewhere, and so I would say dependent in that sense.
And how does that? How does the moral experience come out of it? In the word political.
Yeah, I like ethical in a way better than moral, ethical, because ethical is, you know, keeps character in mind rather than rules and regulations, mm-hmm. Right? So, and I think it fits better with, with this kind of dependency. But if one wants to move in the direction of moral, but this, you know, there's, I think, a certain experience in terms of the experience of one's own pride, spiritedness, of inviolability, and that might be one origin for it, a certain kind of reverence or inviolability. I mean, you couldn't have that alone and apart from this dependence, right? But I would say maybe something like that could be.
Never discuss a woman's menstrual condition.
Well, it won't prevent you from becoming president, though. You didn't. So, what greater goal can that be for a political scientist?
Even Kennedy didn't get that far.
Yeah, Kennedy, the virtue incarnate, John F. Kennedy. Yeah.
Well, yeah, sure. Just to jump in on this, why, if you talked about the regime and talked about man as a political animal, but I mean, why wouldn't Aristotle says we are political to the extent that we share in a perception of justice. But you were speaking of you were speaking in amoral terms of dependence and these and pride and things. But it seems to me that for all of the regimes and all human communities, according to the Aristotelian analysis, each of them shares in some perception of justice, and call that moral or ethical, whatever you want.
I also then say,
are you avoiding that on purpose? Or would you grant that?
Yeah, I said a couple of things about, without developing them, of course, reverence and inviolability.
Yeah.
Because I, you know, one difficult question in all of this is to find the right place for regimes based on natural rights mm-hmm. with, in their connection to, let's say, Plato and Aristotle. I think to talk of reverence and inviolability is not morally neutral, right?
Okay. But,
and I would even go so far as to say that part of the experience of what one might mean by justice or non-neutrality, right, is connected to that.
But would you say Aristotle should have said, man is a political animal to the extent that human beings share in a perception of reverence and inviolability?
No, I'm happy with Aristotle.
Okay.
As he,
or, but, as that's he, why I was wondering as, whether as why says, avoid
well,
the word.
I don't mean
words.
To be, in,
okay.
I mean, justice is a version of justice is the cause of or name for the fullness of all of these experiences as properly put together within a regime. So, in the fullest sense, I think that would be I think acceptable. So, I don't mean to be value free. Yeah.
I was wondering if I might ask about sort of what you suggested at the beginning about nostalgical reasoning and then say where religious epistemology enters into the question. Sort of assume for a moment sort of the, you know, the classical division, natural reason, revelation. I'm trying to kind of think of like Plato's line, I forget from where we will inquire about the good life, the blessed life, up until the gods reveal it to us, what it consists of. But where would this be? Where would it still be this kind of, would it be the same kind of discursive reasoning one experience in context with coming into communion with others until it gives us a grander vision and we reach the limits of that? Or,
you know, I think so maybe ultimately because a revelation has to be intelligible. And when you spell out its intelligibility, to whom is it talking? What is it commanding? When you spell it out, you're spelling it out in natural terms, or if you don't like natural terms, the terms that, let's say, Heidegger discusses in Being and Time about what the voice of conscience is saying. But one way or another, it needs to be intelligible in terms of speaking to you, in terms of your choices, and so on. And it seems to me that that puts it certainly to begin with, and then as you work it through on a natural plane, that's what I would say.
Okay, so the limits of there would just be the normal limits of human discourse and inquiry, then apply to some some
yeah,
outside.
But I don't think, but then I'll say something in addition. I don't think that you can get beyond that for an intelligible revelation, I suppose, is what I'm saying. You know, I don't think you could get beyond that, actually.
Okay. Two things. What is the richness that you allude to, the historical understanding that's brought to us and that we have to incorporate in a teaching like yours? And secondly, it seems to me that your answer in the previous question is not quite right. That is to say, justice encompasses all these experiences, but it's not clear to me that many of our experiences, especially of many people, are not just. There are many experiences. So I wonder if simply put, you don't still need some beginning point in justice and the doubtfulness of justice. That is, there are different opinions about justice. Yeah. One thing that hasn't come out in your talk is the importance of just contradictions, and political contradictions, but also, in a sense, moral contradictions, mm-hmm. in everyday life, and the way that provokes a kind of thoughtfulness. But I'm more interested in the question that's come up about kind of your standard and how that begins.
I meant justice politically. I don't mean to say that justice encompasses every experience, but it encompasses, and meant to encompass, if it's the standard for a regime, all the experiences that as they announce themselves politically. To the point you just made, the clash of opinion is already within a developed regime. So it's the beginning of thought from what is already a kind of political community. You don't have, I don't think, certainly not explicitly, clashes of opinion about justice in reverent places, in religious places, in places in which there's only one right way. You certainly don't have it in communities which are not sufficiently political, but look like villages or nations. So it's not, I don't think, the case that simply empirically this is the only beginning point that one sees. One sees this as a fundamental beginning point in certain places. All I said about history and these historical things is that one has to deal with this notion that of a so-called hermeneutic circle, that all discussion and interpretation and analysis starts from somewhere and can never simply leap beyond that to something presumably absolute. That's all I meant. The second thing I would add to that is that if you're looking at things forward from Plato and Aristotle, one has to find an adequate understanding of an explanation for all of these deep thinkers who came afterwards. Right? Then you went, yeah. So, which you could call this history, or natural right in history, if you like. Yeah.
Again, one follow up with Aristotle. It seems so in book three of the Politics, he says at a certain point that everyone thinks that justice is giving equals to equals, and everyone also thinks that it's the common good. So one point to make about that is that I don't think he means just Greek city-states as they're presently formed. I mean, maybe he would not include, you know, subhuman tribal creatures or something like that.
Or maybe the village and the family, these
well, I would doubt that he would deny that to them as well. I mean, uh-huh. It seems to me, to the extent that human beings are human beings, they speak to one another and they make certain judgments about what is owed or fitting. And maybe they don't gain clarity except in certain political forms. And that's one of the reasons why cities are superior to villages, or just living in a household with someone. But it seems to me, to the extent that they're human beings, they do have something like these opinions. And these opinions aren't simply imposed by the culture that has developed.
But do they take them as opinions, or do they take them as clashes? It could certainly be that you visiting them could begin to bring that out. Socrates is visiting Athens, where this is already
democracy.
And he's visiting a certain kind of democracy. Yeah. And if you know, you listen to Nietzsche, corrupt one at that. So that would be the question: whether, on their own, in and of themselves, that's the case. And I don't know that that's clearly so.
But you're granting that they perhaps do hold both a version of both of these opinions, but they don't have clarity that they hold them as opinions, or are you denying that they even hold these?
No, what I'm saying is that they can certainly be opened up as opinions in some way with various experiences, but that would be a change in their way of life already in many of these cases. A good place to look for this, you know, there's this chapter in Strauss's Natural Right and History on the origin of natural right, whatever he means by origin there. That's, I think, a good place to see one way to think about the beginning of a possible clash of opinion, the beginning of external evidence, the dissolution of authority. Perhaps another way to say this is that if authority is so fully authoritative,
yeah,
as it certainly would be, were it the case that you had a frightening and awe-inspiring, masterful God from the beginning, but maybe other ways, that it's not clear that this natural possibility, which I'm not denying, okay, and I'm sure we're agreeing on that, would spring to life, or could spring to life. You need somehow a weakening or lessening of that.
Mm-hmm. You go now to your conference on Scalia,
yeah,
who was the author of The Doctrine of Originalism. And this paper seems to be your preparation for that.
that's right.
I'm sure they'll be as enlightened as we are. Thanks very much. Yeah. It's lovely to see you here again.
Yeah, great to be here.
Reception outside.
Thanks. Oh. So you had a question I didn't get to.
No, I was gonna ask, how do you bridge the divide between the people who deny that man is a political animal,
yeah,
and the people who assume that?
Yeah. Well, I would argue, so the people who don't think that they're incorrect. I think one can show that to them ultimately.
Without begging the question.
Yeah, I think without begging the question, once one sees what the question is, right? I mean, you've stated it in a certain general way. So once we work out the substance of what those claims are, I think the usually easiest way you do that, and this may be insufficient,
yeah,
is to show that full human happiness requires something more than the satisfaction of desires as you could imagine that or even enjoy it isolated, either in some Rousseauian way or some Hobbesian way or so on. And then someone would need to claim, no, that is sufficient for human happiness. And I think you could then begin your argument. And that'd be one way I would go about trying to do it.
Right. Well, maybe neither would be sufficient for human happiness. I mean,
maybe so. But nonetheless, I think I could my step up from happiness is the satisfaction of such desires as you could imagine satisfying with alone, as it were, the relief of unease in a certain sense. Why that is insufficient in various ways. I couldn't prevent you from choosing that, of course, since you're free. So, right. Okay, sorry.